Romans chapter 5 was where we had our reading, and that's where we're going to start this morning. This afternoon. We've just crept into the afternoon. So Romans chapter 5, and it's a big, big chapter. And I don't intend to speak about the whole chapter. That's not my purpose. I would love to, but we would be here a long time. It would take a long time to preach Romans. I'm told that, and I don't know how true it is, but I remember hearing that law students used to be given Romans, the epistle of Paul to the Romans, to study, to help them form and frame a legal mindset, because there's of course a legal argument here in terms of our justification, our salvation, our redemption from a legal perspective. It's of course very much the epistle to the Romans is about that, and it covers so many things. But Romans chapter 5 is a powerful one. And so we're going to look at some things. We're justified by faith. That means we're made righteous by faith. We'll look at that in a minute. And because of that, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to speak today on the favour of God, or the grace of God. I like to use the word favour because grace, of course, is unmerited favour. So we'll use those terms interchangeably. But it tells, and the reason I use favour is because we understand favour maybe more than we understand grace, because we all understand what it's like to be a favourite, don't we? I'm Agnes's favourite, am I, Agnes? But our three children all say the favourite child, don't they? It's like a competition. But we understand favour. Favour means to prefer someone. Favour means to pick someone over others. Favour means if you're someone's favourite, then that you get preferential treatment. You're preferred. You get special advantages. Of course, favour from the Bible perspective, or grace, is the divine advantage that sustains us and puts us over in life, that makes us victors, that makes us more than conquerors. The favour of God, the grace of God. And it's appeared to all men. The favour of God is all over the place, but we are not always conscious of it. Okay? And the purpose of this message is to make us conscious that we are God's favourites. You know, in the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, when Israel entered the Promised Land, there were all kinds of tribes there. There were the Hittites and the Amalekites, all these, the different ites. Well, we are favourites. Amen? So we're the tribe that matters. We're the tribe that God kicks all the other tribes out for. Okay? And that's still the same today. God still wants to show grace and favour and preferential treatment to his people. And I believe that when that happens to such an extent, that will make others want to come and join. The Bible tells us that the mountain of the Lord's house will be above all the other mountains, which means God will show favour to his people, and people will say, let's go up there to join the favourites. Amen? That's what happens in revival, is that people say, I want to be a child of God. Amen? So we need that, and we pray for that every week. Okay, so it says here, I want to show you something in verse 2, by whom, meaning the Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace. Faith is what you need to access God's grace and favour. Okay? If you want preferential treatment, if you want the blessing, because the place of blessing is the place of favour, if you want to access those things that God has set aside for us, then you need faith for the access. Okay? And I'll tell you what won't give you access is good deeds, or striving in the flesh, or thinking that because you help old ladies across the road and you give bags every week to Oxfam, that you'll get God's favour. No, no, no. These things come by faith. What does that mean? By receiving what God's word says. And God's word says you have faith. You have grace. You have the favour of God in your life if you are a child of God by faith in Christ Jesus. So we have access by faith into this favour, into this grace, this unmerited favour, wherein we stand. And you see, you're supposed to stand in favour. Instead of saying, well, I'm always unlucky in life. Folks, that is against the grace of God. That is against God's favour. You ought to be saying, I'm always favoured by God. I'm always blessed, even when I'm going through hard times. Especially when I'm going through hard times, that's when the favour of God kicks in. That's when the grace of God carries me through. And God is looking for a people who will simply believe his grace, believe his favour, believe that you are preferred by him. You know, anyway, let's just read on. It says, I'm trying to rattle through this so we get to where I want us to go with this, because it's so important. So I'm going to jump some verses, folks. Quite a bit, in fact. But you need to know three things in life. You need to know you're blessed, you need to know you're favoured, and you need to know you're loved. That's so important. And you need to say these things. Like we said earlier on, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You're redeemed into the favour of God. You're redeemed into grace, into blessing, and into a place where you're accepted in the love of God. So, let's just go towards the end, because that's what I want us to look at, that I believe the Lord wants us to see. And it says here in verse, it talks about how one man, the disobedience of one man, of course, who was Adam, brought death, brought condemnation, brought the fall of man and all these things. And it brought all the bad stuff that once we were bound by. But it says here, let's just read from verse 14. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, because Adam fell. Even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. A couple of things here. What it's saying is that we didn't eat the forbidden fruit. But nonetheless, the death that came into the human race, or the Adamic race, when Adam ate the forbidden fruit, came upon us, came upon mankind. Amen? So we didn't do it. And you can say, well, you know, if I was there, I wouldn't have done it. Well, that might be so, but you would have done it for the simple reason you were born in Adamic nature. Okay? And even if you didn't eat the forbidden fruit, you were a sinner by nature. You were sinned by nature. Okay? And it's all because of Adam. So there's no point in blaming Adam, because it's pointless. But Adam's sin brought death, and brought sin, and brought sickness, and brought all the world that we know as a fallen world and a fallen human race. And then it says, but it says here that Adam was the figure of him that is to come. Adam is the federal head of the human race from the Garden of Eden. But the Bible speaks about the last Adam. In other words, another Adam to come. Some say the second Adam, but the Bible uses the term the last Adam. So there's no more Adams to come. Okay? But then it says, but not as the offence, so also is the free gift, verse 15. What's he talking about, free gift? The free gift is the gift of righteousness and grace. Okay? For if through the offence of one, many be dead. In other words, because Adam offended God, because he fell, because of his sin, because he listened to his wife. Now, folks, I have to say this, that is the big downfall. Okay, when you listen to the wife, and that was Adam's downfall, amen. Adam's great offence was he listened to his wife. She said, doesn't this fruit look very tempting and shiny? Do you want to have some? And he should have said no, but of course he didn't. And there we go. So the offence of the many, because of that, many be dead. In other words, death came upon the human race because of Adam's sin. And I want to say this to you, I want to point this out to you, and it's important to say this. Eve's not really mentioned here, okay? The responsibility was Adam's, okay? So, just balancing the books, ladies. It says here, for if through the offence of one many be dead. Now, this is what I like, because we like to talk about Adam's fall. We talk about the sin that came in. We talk about the darkness that came in. We talk about the horrific nature of the fall. And we think, oh, it was terrible. One man's offense. And look at the human race. Look at all the wars. Look at all the violence. Look at all the horrible things that go on. Look at the darkness that's in the earth these days, and so on, because of Adam. But look what the Bible says. Look what the Bible says. The Bible acknowledges the offense of one, many be dead. Death came because of one man's offense. But look what God's word says. Much more, much more, much more. In other words, far more powerful than Adam's transgression, far more powerful than the death that came upon the human race because of Adam's fall. Much more the grace of God. Much more God's favor, God's loving kindness, God's heart of love, God's heart of mercy, God's grace and favor, and desire to bless and lift us up out of the darkness that came upon the earth through Adam. Much more the grace of God and the gift by grace. You see that? The gift by the favor of God, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. What he's saying here is the favor of God, the grace of God that came through the one man, Jesus Christ, the last Adam, is far more powerful than the death and sin and destruction and bondage that came through the one man's transgression, which was the first Adam. In other words, favor and grace is far more powerful than what came into the earth through the fall. God had an answer to the serpent's sowing of the seed of death and disobedience to God. God had an answer, and it was far more powerful than Adam's transgression, far more powerful than the serpent's poison that came into the earth. Much more the favor of God and the gift by grace. Much more it's abounded unto many. Grace is more abundant and abounding than the death that came through Adam. And you and I need to know that. You and I need to know that being a Christian is not holding on grimly till the end. It's an abundant life. Jesus said, I come that they might have abundant life. I come that you might walk in the abundant blessing and grace and honor and love and mercy and power that comes from the Holy Spirit. It's far more abundant by scale than what came through Adam. And let me tell you, we all know what came through Adam, because, you know, we've all read the news, we've all experienced things in our lives, we've all seen things, horrific things. But far more abundant is the grace that came through Christ Jesus, the last Adam. And not as it was by one that sinned, so as the gift for the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offences unto justification. That's a little bit sort of a, you need to twist your mind around that a little bit to understand what he's saying. But what he's saying again is he's just reiterating that what came through Adam, far more, even although there was many, many offences, there was many, many sins, death came upon the human race, but God's solution was more powerful. The gift that God gave, which is his righteousness in Christ, imparted and imputed unto us the minute that you become a believer in Christ Jesus, a son or daughter of the Most High. We don't enter apprenticeship, brothers and sisters. That's the thing. We don't enter a place where if we do good, then God will elevate us, and elevate us in the sense of we'll get better and better. There's no self-improvement program here. It's simply you go from death in Adam to life in Christ. You go from being in bondage to being a king and a priest unto God, to being a joint heir with Christ instantly, a son and daughter of the Most High God, just like Jesus is. Amen? Instantly. Well, we enter a program that, you know, maybe if we're good. No, folks, that is your status the minute you accept Christ. And you just have to live it and live it out and walk it out. Okay? Full status and privilege is given to you the minute you receive Christ as Lord and Savior. These are the things we need to know. Amen? Now, of course, there is spiritual growth, we do grow into it, but our status, our position. Let me just say this to you, you'll never be more righteous than you are right now. We grow in holiness, which means we grow in our separation to God and in our walk with God, but you don't grow in righteousness, because righteousness is a gift. Amen? Now, if you're born into a family, you don't say, well, I'll be a child, I'll be a son, if I go through some program or apprenticeship. If you're born, your mum's your mum and your dad's your dad, and you're a son or you're a daughter. Does that make sense? Well, it's the same in God's family, in that you are a son or a daughter of God the minute you are a Christian. So, the free gift of righteousness. Righteousness is imputed, and righteousness is imparted. It's your position, it's your status in Christ. Okay? Okay, now let's press on. So it says here, verse 17 is where I want us to go with this. If by one man's offence, death reigned by one. Death reigned over the human race the minute Adam ate the forbidden fruit. And I just want to point out, if you don't know this, the Bible doesn't say it was an apple. Okay? So whatever that forbidden fruit was, and some people have different ideas. Some people say it's a metaphor, and other people say it was an actual fruit. The key thing is Adam ate the forbidden fruit at Eve's prompting. Again, I'll say that. But Adam ate that, and we're not being glib about this, folks. This was a terrible moment. But it says, by one man's offence, death reigned. Death came upon the planet, death came upon the human race, death came upon us all the minute they partook of that forbidden fruit. But again, the Bible says much more. Much more. In other words, far greater than that, far more important than that, far more powerful than that, far more pervasive than that. They which received abundance of grace. God does not give you grace and favour in small amounts. He gives it in abundance. Why? Because abundance of grace is what we need. A little dab here and a little dab there. See, many Christians have learned to settle for a little bit of grace and favour every now and again to keep me going, folks. That's not Bible. Okay? You ought to be so bold as to say to God every morning, I'm looking for my abundance of grace and favour today. I'm looking for it to superabound. I'm looking to superabound in grace and favour today. And let me tell you, people who do that, they receive it. All kinds of crazy things happen to people who know that they have the grace and favour of God in their lives. I could tell you stories that might get round to that. But if by one man's offence, in other words, if the terrible thing that happened through Adam's fall and transgression, or humankind's fall, death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. What he's saying here is this, is that death reigned over you and Adam, but the minute you turn to Christ, that you reign in him, by him, through him. And that word reign in life, it literally means in the Greek to reign as a king. So I like to say that we reign as kings in life. Because that's what the Bible says. That word means to reign as kings, to reign as royalty in life. Okay, so let me just say this to you. We have a king. We prayed for him earlier. We will continue to pray for him. We honour our royal house. It's great to have kings. It's great to have these positions of authority. But let me tell you, every believer in Christ is a king and priest unto God. And if you're a king and priest, you're supposed to reign. Okay, you're supposed to step into your position, step into your authority, step into that which God has given you. And I will say this to you, I'll be so bold. If you don't, it's an insult to him. Amen. It's an insult to not walk in that which God has provided for you. Can I get some amens in here? So it says here, therefore, as by the offence of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation through Adam, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. Folks, the favour of God makes you reign in life. The favour of God makes you a king. The favour of God makes you an overcomer. The favour of God puts you in the God class of being, in the sense that God elevates us to say that you will now walk in the righteousness of God. Righteousness doesn't just mean you live right and do the right thing and say the right thing. Righteousness is a realm. Righteousness is a position. Righteousness is something that's bestowed. To have righteousness, that old-fashioned word, right standing. You know, when we were in Adam, we didn't have right standing with God. We couldn't have access to him because he wouldn't have our sin in his presence. So he gave us the gift of righteousness so that we could enter into his presence and we can come boldly to the throne of grace. You know, God's throne is not a throne of condemnation. God's throne is a throne of favour. So we can come boldly to him. God likes bold and cheeky and rude Christians. And I mean that in the sense of, you know, that we're, you know, we all like a cheeky child, don't we? Cheeky chappies, you know. We all like kids who, you know, I had a friend when I was a boy, and, you know, my mum was a big stickler for manners. But this boy, this pal of mine, Brian, he used to come and stay with me, and he would come in, and he would be like, he would say to my mum, "You're putting the kettle on, Mrs. McMurdo." Now, I could have brought a number of people home that would have said that to my mum. And she would have said, "Don't bring him back. That's the last he'll be in this house." But my mum liked this boy saying that because it was cheeky, but, you know, it was the right type of cheeky, if that makes sense. And God likes that. God wants people to come boldly and say, "Lord, where's mine? Where's mine? Where's my portion?" Why? Because you're expecting. That's faith. That's why God blessed Jacob, or God liked Jacob, stealing the birthright from Esau. Because he coveted the blessing of God. And God likes his children who covet the blessing and who are rude and bold and demand it. You know, that's why when God looked upon the shepherd boy, he said, "This wee boy's a heart after mine." Because he will not take no for an answer. He expects everything. He expects every blessing he can get. You go and read the Psalms and you'll see that was what David's heart was. Amen? And he, you know, I think David was quite cheeky at times, but God liked him and loved him for it. And God likes us to be like that, to be demanding of his blessing. Okay? Anyway, so let's turn to Ephesians chapter 2. Just before we do that, sorry, there's a couple of things we should cover here. Before we do that, verse 20 says, "Moreover, the law entered that the offence might abound." The law was given to us to show us where we had messed up. To show us. It was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. It was to show us the wickedness of our heart. You know, the Bible says that man's heart is desperately wicked. Okay? But I want to say this to you. That's fallen man's heart. Okay? That's talking about man and Adam. Okay? He's not talking about the man in Christ. He's not talking about the new creation in Christ. He's talking about humanity under Adam. Now, it says here, "The law entered that the offence might abound, that the law would show us the desperate deceitfulness of our heart. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound." I don't know that we really understand what that's saying, brothers and sisters. When we actually think about what it's saying, it's very difficult almost to believe it in the natural. What he's really saying here is the more sin there is, the more favour and grace God throws at that. Okay? So that's why, you know, we always have these, we rejoice when we hear people who have really lived wicked lives and, you know, all kinds of terrible things, and when they get saved, because you can't out-sin the grace of God. And even sometimes if you've been backslidden and you've really fallen away from God, The grace of God always pulls you back. Why? Because the worst things are. You see, none of us deserve God's grace. None of us deserve the favor of God. But here's the thing about it, which is wonderful, is that you qualify the more for grace, the worse you are. Does that make sense? You know, some people have lived goody two-shoes lives and have never really fallen away from God and so on. But you think of trophies. That's why we call them trophies of grace. Men and women who've gone so far away, and yet the favor of God, it's nothing else but the grace of God. We don't get saved by anything else. You don't get saved because you lived a good life. You don't get saved because, you know, you were born into a ministerial family, or, you know, your daddy was the archbishop. It doesn't matter. It doesn't work that way. The worse you are, the more you qualify for the favor of God. That's what that verse tells us. Where sin abounds, well, you know, the favor of God just runs faster and runs stronger and overwhelms it and overcomes it. The favor and grace of God is overwhelming and cannot be defeated. It's indestructible. It's unbeatable. And you can't out. So you think about, I love to hear about all these really wicked people, Satanists and witches and so on, getting gloriously saved. Because these people do their very best to annihilate any grace in their lives by getting involved in what they do, the occult and everything else, or all kinds of sin. And yet the grace of God grabs them. Irresistible grace, as we call, as the Calvinists call it. You know, I like that term, sovereign grace. It's a wonderful thing, because sovereign grace is really all about, if God chooses to show you grace, you can do nothing about it. He's chosen to favor you. He's chosen to save you. He's chosen to make you his child. And it is irresistible. Okay? Now, some of us have tried hard to resist that grace. And others just surrender the minute we hear about it. But whatever your condition is, the favor of God abounds to you. That as sin hath reigned unto death, because sin reigned unto death when the fall of Adam, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. So, anyway, let's just press on. Go to Ephesians chapter 2. We've got a few minutes left. And then we'll, I think we'll come back to this subject. I could preach in the favor of God every Sunday, every Lord's Day, okay? Because it's such an important thing, the grace of God. I remember a brother who used to talk about the doctrines of grace. And the doctrines of grace, he says, will destroy everything in its path. Basically what he was saying, the doctrines of grace will destroy every religious thing that comes against it. Amen? That's why the Reformation spread like wildfire, because people discovered God loves me, God favors me, God blesses me, God wants me, not religion, which says the total opposite. Amen? So, Ephesians chapter 2 says, you has he quickened, we were dead in trespasses and sins. For the sake of brevity, let's just jump down now. It says here, verse 4, God who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, which you've heard about, hath quickened us, or made us alive together with Christ. By grace, by grace, by grace ye are saved. What saved us, brothers and sisters? The grace of God. The favour of God. The sovereign grace where God looked at us and said, I'm going to save you. I'll back it up legally by putting all that stands between us upon my Son, which we remembered earlier. But God sovereignly chose to grace us, to favour us, to look at us and say, I'm going to show you love, mercy, kindness. I will do that for you. You see, grace is a decision. Grace is a choice that God made, a decision he made to show us his grace and mercy because we didn't deserve it. And he backed it up on the legal side by putting all that stood between us upon his Son. But it was his heart that was moved. It wasn't just a legal, or let's just all be legalistic. God had no reason to do that except for the fact he chose to. And he chose to by his great love wherewith he loved us. Then it says, in the ages to come, in other words, what's the future? What's the future in history, and what's the future in eternity? Well, let me just say, eternity isn't the future, because eternity is out with time, but you understand what I mean. In the ages to come, he might show us the exceeding riches of his grace. You see, everything that God does is about his grace, his mercy, his favour, his heart of love towards us. He might show us, what's your future? Oh, what's the future? Pastor, what's the future? Well, the future is that in the ages to come, he might show you and I the exceeding riches of his grace. In other words, more and more favour. What's in your future, brothers and sisters? More and more favour. More and more grace. More and more God showing you how much he loves you. You see, when you read the Bible, you believe that or you see that. But when you listen to religion, religion tells you it's all about, oh, well, you've got to learn God's approval and so on. So grace is a gift. So God's going to give you more and more of the grace that he's already given you in the ages to come, that he might show the riches of his grace, exceeding riches, not just a little bit of riches, exceeding in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith. By grace, by the favour of God, you're saved through faith. And it is the gift of God. Favour is the divine advantage in life that God gives you and I. Favour is God preferring you. Favour, of course, is supernatural. Amen? Favour is supernatural. There's a lot more I want to, and I've got it here, but I'm going to leave it here because we will come back to this subject. I will say this. Ephesians 2 verse 8 says that we are saved by grace through faith. You see that? You're saved by the favour of God. You're saved by God's grace, by his unmerited favour, by his choosing to favour you, by his choosing to show you kindness and mercy and grace. But look at this. You must use your faith to receive and walk in the benefits of God's grace and favour. If there's no faith, then you can't activate the grace. Okay? So, before we close, I just want to show you this. Psalm 23. We'll close with this. Psalm 23 and verse 6. It's such a wonderful little truth that the Lord showed me a while back. And a parting thought, if you like. We all know Psalm 23, don't we? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack. I shall not want. I shall not do without his grace. Look at verse 6. Surely goodness and mercy, we know these words, shall follow me, or what it really means, will chase after me. Isn't it good to know God's goodness and mercy will chase after you all the days of my life? Every day, all the days. Every day God's goodness and mercy is hunting you down. Well, how do you want, let me just put it this way, if you want God's goodness and mercy to overtake you and overwhelm you, here's what to do. Stop running. Stand still and say, I receive it. Amen? Goodness and mercy, if it's chasing after you, then stop running. What it really means is that God has dispatched goodness and mercy after you every day of your life. If you want to experience it, then stop and let it overtake you. Then it says, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. But that's wonderful, and goodness and mercy are wonderful things to think about. But what I want to say to you is, they're both different Hebrew words. Goodness and mercy. But both of the words can be translated as favour. So he says, surely favour and other kinds of favour follow me all the days of my life. That's what it's really saying in the Hebrew. Double favour is chasing after you and I, brothers and sisters. The double portion of favour. God is not just interested in blessing you with favour. He gives us a double portion. So stop running from it. It's following you. So all you need to do to let it catch up, stand still and say, I receive it today. I receive my double portion of favour today. Amen. I want to say this to you, just in closing. The favour, the grace of God, which is unmerited, of course, in the sense that we could never ever buy it, earn it, whatever, is a vast subject. In fact, the Bible goes so far as to say that the Bible itself, the Word, is the Word of His grace. The Word of His favour. This book is a favour book. It's a grace book. If you want to encounter the grace of God, then all you need to do is open this book and start reading, start meditating, start praying it, start receiving it. Because, and the Bible says, when you receive the Word of His grace, it will build you up and give you an inheritance. Amen. I could go on. I'm not here in Christ. Just keep going, Pastor. So we'll leave it there, brothers and sisters, for today. Praise the Lord. And we'll come back to this wonderful favour word next time or in the near future.